Hello and welcome to this short preview presentation for ICTFA 2020 tutorial in Pasadena. I'm Jörg Jatzkowski from Fraunhofer IMWS in Germany, and I will show you some possible applications of EBIC and EBAC techniques for fault isolation. First, I will give you a brief overview of the EBIC principle, followed by some applications in microelectronics before I will switch to the EBAC method. Here I will show you the possibility of breakdown localization on a thin dielectric layer, e.g. a capacitor structure. Before we start with the EBIC method, a few comments why these methods are very helpful for fault isolation. In general, these are additional or complementary methods for defect localization, such as emission microscopy or OBERGE. By using an SEM, they enable very high resolution and analysis of small IC structures. In addition, current imaging techniques use a very small electrical dissipation power at the defect itself and could avoid a modification of the defect. EBIC is typically used to visualize a space charge region for PN junctions, e.g. of capacitor or diode structures. EBAC is often used for metal tracing and network analysis, but also enables breakdown and weak point localization at thin oxide layers of capacitor or large gate structures. Just a few comments to the EBIC principle. When the electron beam of the SEM interacts with the doped structure of a PN junction, electron hole pairs are generated by the primary electrons. If the beam scans an n-doped area, the electron hole pairs can easily recombine in place. The same thing will happen at the p-doped area. However, if the electron beam scan a depletion zone between N and p-doped material, a part of the generated electron hole pairs are separated by the internal electrical field due to the built-in voltage of the PN junction. These separated carriers can be measured with a connected sensitive current amplifier. Typically, this measured current is superimposed, in our case in red, to the SEM image generated at the same time. If we talk about EBIC in microelectronic structures, we could have a top-down imaging or a cross-section view. For the top-down view, the covering metal layers often have to be removed by chemical polishing or focused ion beam assisted methods. This source depletion zone of a high voltage transistor could be visualized after CMP preparation down to contact level. For cross-section investigations, mechanically prepared samples or focused ion beam techniques can be used. This diode structure was investigated after mechanical cross-section preparation. A local connection of the prepared structure is often necessary and typically realized by probing at contacts or at metal lines. After connecting a PN junction, it's important to understand the structure and the method itself. Here you can see two EBIC images of a high voltage NMOS transistor with an additional P-well and N-well structure underneath. Both images use the same connections, P-well and N-well, and SEM parameters. Only the accelerating voltage is different. 7 kV at the left image and 10 kV at right. the 7 kV image shows only the contact row of the P-well and a small signal at the edge of the P-well. At 10 kV, you could see more or less the homogeneous signal of the entire P area. The reason is the different interaction volume of both used accelerating voltages. At 7 kV, the primary electrons can only reach the middle of the P-well, like this line. Then the EBIC signal comes from the contact doping and from the sidewall of the P-well here and only here. By increasing the accelerating voltage, the electrons can be reached the bottom of the P-well. Now the EBIC signal is coming from the sidewall and the bottom of the P-well. Therefore, we see more or less the entire area of the P-well. Therefore, it's important to align the beam in the correct way. Another point to consider is the polarity of the used connections. Here you can see a transistor connected at source and drain. The amplifier zero line was set to around 50% so that we can see a negative current less than 50% in black and a positive current higher than 50% here in red. But if you had a closer look to the connected structure, both are identical. An N-doped structure at a P-doped substrate connected by a tungsten plug. So the induced current is separated in the space charge region and electrons can easily transport to the N-doped area and measured by the amplifier. Separated holes are blocked by the second PN junction. The current direction through the amplifier is in that case from left to right. By scanning the second junction, we have the same situation, but now the current direction at the amplifier is from right to left. This was the case at the reference sample of our transistor under investigation. However, if we connect only one of the doped structure at the failing transistor, we can visualize both source and drain area. This is only possible if there is a short, in this case, a high ohmic short between source and drain. The following TEM investigations shows a clear abnormal contrast at one side of the active transistor area. However, the material analysis shows only silicon in this area. This identifies an area with amorphous silicon as origin of the small leakage current between source and drain. The following case study shows the possibility of EBIC at mechanical prepared cross-section. This suspicious PMOS transistor here and here shows an increased threshold voltage and reduced output level without any leakage currents. We did the mechanical preparation in the middle of the transistor. And in the optical cross-section view, we see the exposed metal lines that we can use to connect the source, the drain, and the well of the transistor. At source structure, the EBIC image shows the expected shape, especially close to the gate structure. Unfortunately, the contrast of the SEM image is a little bit less, therefore the yellow dotted line to emphasize the position of the polysilicon gate. At the drain structure, the EBIC image looks different. Left edge of the depletion zone is much closer to the contact. The gate is again marked with the yellow dotted line. The red dotted line should be the normal position of the depletion zone. But in general, the doped structure exists, only the shape fails. Therefore, the transistor shows no leakage. However, the increased channel length during smaller doped drain area could explain the increased threshold voltage and reduced output level. These two examples, one for top-down and one for cross-section view, should demonstrate the ability to investigate doped areas of single structures by EBIT. The second main topic of the tutorial deals with the EBAC method. It's often used to investigate metal networks to find an open or short, but it could also be used to localize breakdowns in thin dielectric layers, e.g. of capacitor oxides. The capacitor is typically formed by a large polysilicon plate and the substrate as second plate, isolated by a thin dielectric layer. This structure must be separated from surrounding parts and connected locally. If the polysilicon plate is now scanned with the electron beam of the SEM, a part of the generated carriers can be absorbed by the polysilicon plate and measured by the amplifier. If the capacitor oxide is broken in this area, a part of the absorbed current can flow to the substrate and reduce the signal at the amplifier. In this application, the EBAC signal is often inverted to have a bright spot, but it's a reduced signal in real. Here you can see a part of a very large capacitor structure with a non-inverted EBAC signal and a large spot close to the contact row of the capacitor structure. We connect the polysilicon plate and the substrate outside field of view. Furthermore, we aligned the beam in that way that we could reach the polysilicon plate. In that case, 8 kV are required to reach this the poly level after preparation down to contact level. The following TEM investigation shows a large affected breakdown area. Typically, the breakdown occurs when the capacitor is charged, and especially for a large capacitor structure, when the breakdown occurs, the discharge creates a large molten area and avoids a visualization of the root cause. However, it's a generally, or if you have a generally oxide weakness and one can investigate unstressed samples by EBAC, one can use this method to localize weak points in thin dielectric layers before the breakdown is happen. The preparation and local connections are identical. However, an additional potential between substrate and polysilicon plate is required for the localization. Then it becomes possible to visualize weak points by imaging of something like a tunnel current by hot carrier injection. The mechanism is comparable to a transistor under operating conditions. Electrons coming from the source are accelerated by the drain potential and can overcome the barrier to the gate by the additional electric field during the gate potential. We use the same here. The gate potential creates an additional field for hot carriers. These could easily be generated by the electron beam itself at the substrate level. The measured EBAC current is then modified at the local weak point, and you can localize the weak point. Unfortunately, the tunnel current is typically quite small. Here you can see the EBAC image of an unstressed capacitor structure without any breakdown. No inhomogeneities could be found with zero voltage bias level. At 5.2 volt, however, a very weak signal could be localized. Here you can see the pure current image before overlay. It's easier to identify the weak point. A line scan analysis shows a current difference of only 650 picoamp. Fortunately, the weak point was close to the contact row and allows a direct preparation of a TEM lamella. The TEM investigation shows a very small defect of 20-25 nanometer in size. There is no breakdown and the gate oxide, including a polysilicon layer, is completely homogeneous. The material analysis shows only a very weak oxide signal at the defect position. At this position, a very small substrate defect was filled up by the gate oxide deposition. The change in the oxide thickness creates a local modification of the electric field within the gate oxide by biasing and reduce the local breakdown voltage. If we compare the TEM images of a capacitor defect with and without breakdown, it's obvious that very small defects, e.g. substrate defects without foreign materials inside, couldn't be visualized after breakdown. The area affected by the discharge is much larger than the original defect. In summary, it can be said electron beam-based localization techniques are a powerful extension of existing methods like emission microscopy, Oberth, and so on. The electron beam as a local current source has the great advantage that it enables very gentle localization in order to avoid modifications of the defect during the localization. The EBIC method can be used to visualize PN junction in microelectronics and photovoltaics, as well as in top-down or in cross-section view. The EBIC method is often used for network analysis and can also be used to localize breakdowns in capacitor or transistor structures. Nowadays, a weak point localization is also possible before breakthrough. Finally, thanks for watching, and I hope to see you at ICTFA. Bye-bye.